Hello everyone. Welcome to the second talk by Barış Coşkun Uzer. He's joining us from University of Texas at Dallas, and he's going to tell us about topological machine learning and its applications.
Okay, so as I mentioned in my abstract, I am not assuming any background in machine learning or topology. So hopefully, I mean, if you have any questions, just stop me because I promise everyone should be understanding. So usually in math talks, if you understand first 20 minutes, it's a good math talk, but it's not going to be like that. I hope everyone can understand all of it. So in topological data analysis, so the idea is, so complex data has some shape patterns, and we can use these shape patterns to get some useful information out of the data. And we are gonna look at in this talk topological data analysis as a feature extraction method. You have some data, and I'm gonna create some vectors so that I can use them for some machine learning purposes. So I'm gonna focus on three types of data: point clouds in high dimensions. So most data comes in this form, and you can imagine anything like you make a survey and you ask 10 questions, age, salary, etc., something like that. Every question's answer will give you a coordinate, and you'll have like 1,000 point in 10 dimensional space, something like that. This is a point cloud, for example. And the intuition is, this point class has some shape patterns, and then this is going to be important to classify them. The second one is graphs and networks. These are very complex data. They are very easy to build. Twitter data, Netflix data, etc. For example, in Netflix, there are users and there are movies. When you watch a movie, you put an edge between them. And I'm going to suggest you a new movie. What I'm going to do is, I'm going to look at, for example, the other users with the similar interests, and I'm going to suggest you some new movies the other guys are watching. And then this is called link prediction problem. Graphs are very complex data because you have a very nice graph, and then when you put another edge on this guy, all the distances are changing. Everything is getting very complicated. It's very easy to get, but it's highly complicated from mathematical perspective. And for this complex data, TDA is working very well. I'm going to give you some specific examples on this. Okay, maybe I should use my. Anyway, yeah. Evet.
Ben isterseniz slide'ı değiştirebilir miyim orada?
Yok yok.
Yani şey yapmayacağım zaten.
Ben kontrol istemiyor olacak da. Bir dakika bekleyin, ben kendi şeyimi getireyim.
Var mı sizin?
Var.
Buraya USB ile sokabileceğim. Ha tamam. Direkt
USB'niz var mı? Tamam.
var.
Senin ofisin kilitli mi? Ah, çantam da var da kontrol getirmedim.
There has been a problem with the clicker, so it's going to be replaced. 2 minutes break.
Atlama yapıyor, hiç tutturamıyoruz. Tamamdır. Şimdi olmuşsa
Tamam.
tamam, süper. Okay, so the second type of data is graphs and networks, and third one is the images. So I'm going to focus on these three types, and I'm going to give specific examples about the data types. For graphs and networks, I'm going to tell you about drug discovery problem, how you can use graphs and networks for the graph discovery. For images, I'm going to talk about the cancer detection from histopathological images today. But before that, let me give you some. And in the last 10-15 years, this TDA, topological data analysis, topological machine learning, has been used in many different fields. And if you have some complex data in these forms, you can get some shape patterns, and they might be very useful as a feature extraction method, and it can help deep learning methods, and they can be used with simple machine learning methods too. Okay, so the idea is there is some shape patterns in the data, and then we can use them. For example, if you look at these two-point clouds, I can see that this guy has some large circle pattern, and this guy has some two small circle pattern. So if you look at that, if you look at this, I can see that, but how can I formally get a vector out of it? Okay, so this is the next 10 minutes, I'm going to get a vector out of this point cloud. So homology is one of the ways we detect topological features. And let me give you a simple example about this. If you look at here, when I say zero-dimensional topological feature, all I mean is number of pieces, number of components. If you look at here, this space has six bullets, and that means I have six components. I'm going to tell that H0 is equal to rank six. So there is a group theory, et cetera, here, but it's just ignore that. I have six pieces. This zero-dimensional topological features here. But I don't see any loop here, any hole in my space. So the one-dimensional topological features are basically number of loops, number of holes. And zero here, one-dimensional topological features are none, so it's going to be rank zero. In this space, everything is connected. I can go to any point from other with a path. This is connected space. My zero-dimensional topological features is rank one. But I can see three loops here. That means I have three holes in my space. The one-dimensional homology is rank three, so I'm going to count them. This is basically what it is. And let's look at this more complicated space. If you look at here, concentrating on this brown space, this is all connected. You can see it. So since it's connected all the way, there is one piece, rank, it's going to be rank one, zero-dimensional homology. But let me check the number of holes here. I see one hole here, one hole here, one hole here, one hole here. I have six holes. But if you look at this, this is also a loop, but it's not an essential loop. It's not a hole. It doesn't represent a hole. It is filled. So I'm not going to count them. I'm only going to count the holes, the corresponding loops here. So the rank is six here. This is basically what you need for the following part, the topology part you need for the to follow the next part of the whole talk. Okay, so this is a two-dimensional feature. So zero dimension is a component, one dimensions are holes, and two dimensions are cavities. Sphere, for example, empty sphere is a two-dimensional topological feature. I am not going to use this in this talk. So the idea is, if your data is producing similar shape patterns, they should be in the same class. That's the intuition. So if you have two different classes, and one of the, so you have 1,000 patients, for example, brain tumor, etc. And in the MRI, MRIs, you have some shape patterns you have. 300 of them is some tumor. There are 700 of them non-tumor. The idea is the topological patterns, if they are similar, they are going to be in the same class. If they are not similar, what I'm going to get, then I'm going to call them they are in the same different class. That's the idea. Okay, so so far, so good, but how am I going to get a formal summary out of this? I'll give you some point cloud, graph, or image. How are you going to produce new one vectors? This is coming from persistent homology. Persistent homology is a machinery. This is a black box right now, but I'm going to explain in a minute. You give me a data, I'm going to produce a persistent diagram. And I'm going to, there are three different settings. For point clouds, let me give you an explicit example. So it, persistent homology is a three-step process. The first step is different for any type of data, but the second and third step is always same. So the first step is constructing a filtration. It means you give me a data, I am going to create a sequence of topological spaces coming from the data. How, if you can make this this topological sequence meaningful, then the, your produced vectors are going to be much more powerful. So I'm going to tell you about what I mean by meaningful sequence here. But let me go to point cloud again. And then after getting this sequence of topological spaces, you keep track of the topological changes in this sequence, and then you record them somewhere. We call them persistent diagram. And then persistent diagrams itself are not very useful objects. To use with the machine learning, we vectorize them. This is the third step. I'm going to come to that. So let's go back to this point cloud example. So if you were in this first talk, this is a similar example here. Now, what I have here is basically, I have 15 points. So my zero dimensional homology is 15. There are 15 different pieces. And red bars will represent my zero dimensional homology bars. I start 15 bars here. And I, so the intuition here is when you look far from this point cloud from far away, you cannot distinguish nearby points. You cannot say one of them is the other. You see them as one point. And then if you go farther, you are going to see lots of points as together. So we are going to use this idea to get the shape patterns and by imitating the following idea. So I am going to look at the ball, the disks around the points, and I'm going to increase my radius. And I'm going to change my radius gradually, 0, 0.1, 0.2, and then I'm going to keep track of the topological changes here. I started with 15 components. I increase my radius 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, etc. I reach 0.5, and let's check how many components do I have here. 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So you see, I start with 15, only 5 of them are surviving as component. Some of them merge with the other ones. Whenever I merge them, I'm killing one of them. So it continues that my birth time and death time of the topological feature here. And one of them, so these 5 of them are still surviving. I continue to increase my radius. So when I get to 0.7, all of them get connected, this yellow pieces. When you look at them, I will have one component that it will live forever. So forever I will have, after 0.7, I will have one component and I cannot increase this anymore. And then it will stay forever. So this is my zero dimensional barcode here, red ones. So I started zero, some of them died at 0.2, 0.3, 0.5, and then it continues like that. Blue ones represents one dimensional homology, which means the holes. In here, you don't see any hole. You see here, no hole here, no hole here. But when I reach 0.7, this large circle appears. There is a hole in my space. I'm going to start my bar here. And when I increase my radius to 0.9, this second circle emerge. I'm going to start at 0.9. And then I continue. When I hit 1.3, this hole is closed, filled with these guys. And I'm going to say this circle started at 0.9 and died at 1.3. Similarly, this guy also continues like that. And when you hit 2.5, this is also filled. Now, this is persistent barcode. Red ones represent zero-dimensional homology. Blue ones represent one-dimensional barcode. But I don't need whole bars. I just need initial point and end point. I can record the same information as the persistent diagram. The left endpoint is the birth time. Right endpoint is the dead time. Birth time and dead time, x-axis represents birth time. Y-axis represents dead time. I can record the same information as the persistent diagram. That's it. This is what we have for a point cloud. And then, but at the end of the day, from this, you get this persistent diagram. But so, but what am I going to do with this? You cannot take average of this. This is just a set of points in R2. It doesn't mean anything for us. I want to use with the machine learning. So that means, for example, you have 1,000 patients, etc. 300 of them one class, 700 of them another class. You have 1,000 persistent diagrams. What are you going to do with them? You cannot take the average of them. You cannot do any statistics with them. So these are useless, basically, from a machine learning perspective. We have to vectorize them to use efficiently with the machine learning. The next step is vectorization. There are several tools to vectorize it. From persistent diagram, you can get some meaningful sequence of numbers, vectors, out of this. And then when you use them with the right machine learning tools, it can be very effective. So let me give you a couple of examples for that. The dumbest one, the simplest one, is the Betty function. What you do here is, let's say this is my persistent barcode. I have seven pieces here. And between 0 and 1, how many topological features alive? How many bars do you see here? 2. Between 1 and 2, there are 3 topological features, 3. Between 2 and 3, there are 3 topological features, and you go on like that. This is the Betty function. In each interval, how many topological features you have is your vector. My vector is 7-dimensional. My entries are 2, 3, 3, 3, 3, and 2. That gives me a vector. Now, this is a very dummy, maybe, from person. You are losing lots of information here because the initial time, dead time. But if you have your data has lots of noise, and your noise is the real signature, then Betty functions are very powerful. I'm going to show you some example about this. So Betty function is one way. Another one is the persistent landscape. Basically, this is your persistent. So these 4 points represent your persistent diagram. What you do is you truncate it like this and look at it as a function. So now this becomes a function. And the highest ones are going to be one piece of function. Second highest ones is going to be another piece of function. And third one is going to be another piece of function. You can look at them as vectors too. As long as this is a function, you choose like 10 numbers here. Image of this is your first entry. Image of the second one is another entry. It becomes a vector. And you can use them as a vector too. Now, why is this important? When you get a vector, let's say you have 1,000 patients and you get a vector. So TDA gives you, so let's say 10-dimensional vectors for each. 10-dimensional. So let's say 300 of them are normal, 700 of them abnormal, whatever it is. I have 2 classes, let's say. What you do here is, for each patient, for each data set, you get 10-dimensional vectors. This is basically an embedding. You have 10-dimensional space, and we assume that shape patterns are clearly distinguishes my data set. So 700, so abnormal class is here, and normal class is here, and then my machine learning algorithm just detects this guy. Now, if you give me a new patient, it will come to here, for example, this image, and my machine learning algorithm will tell me it's normal. That's the whole idea. This is basically an embedding method. So feature extraction is an embedding method. You have a latent space, 10-dimensional space, whatever vector I am getting. And then I'm embedding the whole data in the 10-dimensional space. And my machine learning algorithm is going to detect subspaces, blue and red subspaces, and it's going to just detect them. Yes, sure. Shape patterns. Similar shape patterns should give the similar classes. That's the idea. Yes. Shape patterns. So I'm going to give you examples here. But the meaningful here, the TDA, the persistent diagrams, captures the different shape patterns. For example, if you have a circle, large circle like this, your persistent diagram will be 1 point starting at somewhere small, and then it's going to be large. PD1 is going to be like this. But if you have something like this, then your persistent diagram will be 3 points like this. three points very close to the diagonal. Diagonal means birth time and death time is same. It started at 5, died at 5. That means trivial. So diagonal represents the trivial features. If you are far away from the diagonal, for example, it's a real signature. It's a large topological feature. But persistent diagrams capture some information. My intuition is if they're in the same class, they should produce the similar topological patterns. Is it going to work? I don't know. That's the intuition. If it's working, it's working. If it's not, it's not. Yeah, sure. Okay, so what they do usually, you can choose one of them or you can use all of them. So first max is going to be your first vector, 10 dimensional, and concatenate with the other two. Second max is going to give you another 10 dimensional vector. Third one is also going to give you a 10 dimensional vector. And that's going to give you 30 dimensional vector, for example. Yeah, so persistent landscape is not a very useful. I don't like persistent landscape, but it's stable, means stability of our vectorization is important for us. Meaning, if two data sets are close to each other, then your outputs are close to each other. Basically, continuity for us. Stability is important. Beta functions are not continuous, stable. But persistent landscape is stable. So if you have few number of important features, beta functions are not useful. But the persistent landscape is useful because if you remember here, when you are away from the diagonal, then you will have a very large maximum here. So persistent landscape can detect them. But there are much better vectorizations like persistent images, etc. But I'm not going to go into that. Where is the... Okay. Now, for machine learning people, this is my flow chart. You give me a data set. I create a sequence of simplicial complexes. These are all, there are lots of software libraries for this. And then if you give me the sequence, there are lots of, these are all very famous software libraries to compute your persistent diagram. And then how are you going to use them? How are you going to vectorize them is up to you. And then you can use them in any way. It's CNNs, random forests, XGBoost, etc. You can use them, your machine learning algorithm like this. Now I'm going to give you three examples. First one is for the shape recognition. Second one in point class setting, I'm going to give you shape recognition, how we use this TDA features in real life applications. Second one is the graph setting. I'm going to talk about computer-aided drug discovery and how we use TDA in here. And the last one is image setting. It's the cancer detection from histopathological images. That's the idea. I'm going to give you three different examples how we use TDA in real life. So the first example is not one of our work, but it's a very nice, simple example how we use TDA in shape recognition. So in this paper, this is 2015 PMLR paper. So the authors chose four animals. So camel, elephant, flamingo, and lion. These are surfaces in the three-dimensional space. And they randomly chose 500 points on this, 500 points on this, 500 points on this, and 500 points, and they fixed them to represent those animals. And then by like bootstrap, they just choose 300 points out of this 500 randomly 100 different times. I will have 400 point clouds. 100 of them are coming from this. 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 I have four different 100 subsamples out of this. And then let's look at their persistent landscapes. Use point cloud setting. You are going to get persistent diagrams. And then you get persistent landscapes. So I will have 100 persistent landscape for camel, 100 elephant, etc. And let's look at them. The green guys, this confidence band represents flamingo guys. Persistent landscape coming from this 100 flamingo subsamples. Red ones are coming from elephants. The gray ones are coming from camels. and the blue ones are coming from lines. So persistent landscape are clearly distinguishes them very nicely. So this is a very nice example for shape detection. And topological features are working here very well. So this is one of the examples for point cloud. Okay, so in the next one, I'm going to talk about image setting. How do we use the TDA in cancer detection? So this is a collaboration with my Ankur and Faisal are graduate students. Ovidio is in our CS department. Reyhan is in Harvard MGH. And we did this work for five different cancer types and from histopathology images. And TDA methods gave very good results here. So the motivation is, so we want to use clinical decision support systems, meaning, so for any, if you are like, if a doctor is suspected you like any cancer, they have some tissue samples and then they send to a pathologist. And it's a very time consuming method. And also you always need an experienced pathologist for that. And it's really, not so fast enough. So what we can do, we can create some machine learning algorithms to help the pathologist. For example, you give me some tissue samples and I'm gonna prioritize them. I can say that these are very important, someone should look at them immediately. And then we can have a very nice, and my opinion for the machine learning is this, etc. Someone should check them. This is a very nice, this will help the pathologist a lot. So that's the idea. Deep learning methods are very working very well here, but the main problem with deep learning methods, you have to have extensive, very ultra large data sets to train them to get some good results. And it's always black box. You cannot interpret them. And for doctors, it's very important if you don't understand the machine, even though it says there is a problem here, since he doesn't know the reasoning, he cannot trust it. So that's the problem with the doctors. And if I was for example, maybe it's borderline for his algorithm, and I don't know it. So that's the problem. And in here, we are going to get some good feature extraction method, and you can combine with any machine learning and deep learning method with TDA. So that's the idea. Now, again, I told you persistent homology is three-step process. The first step is constructing filtrations. The other two is always same. You get a persistent diagram, and then you get vectorization. Vectorization part and persistent diagrams are always same, but how you create your filtration is depending on your data format. For images, we are using cubical persistence. It's a very simple idea. Now, you give me a histopathological image like this. Every pixel, let's say this is like 2000 by 1500 image here. These are every small square represents a pixel. And every pixel has a color value between 0 to 255. 0 means black, 255 means white. Now, so 90 means, so I am starting from 0 to 255. I'm just giving you three examples here. So this is a binary image. I am activating all pixels whose color value is smaller than 90. Here, I am activating all cells, all pixels, whose color value is smaller than 120. Here, I am activating all pixels whose color value is smaller than 180. And I get a sequence of topological spaces like this. And I'm going to count the number of loops, number of components in this. It will give me some vector with the beta function. Very dummy one, but it works very well here. And I'm going to explain the intuition behind it. So for example, this is a binary image. Not binary image, but let's say this is an image, a grayscale image. And these are the numbers it corresponds to. Remember, this is 0 is white and 255 black is the other way around. But usually 0 is black, 255 is white. And you can imagine if you are a topologist, you can imagine like this is a graph of a function. If you look at here, 0 is a level here, and then these are coming. So this is the graph of a function. What you are doing is you are slicing from bottom to top. You are getting topological spaces like this. This is a sequence of topological, if you want to visualize it. But don't worry about this. I'm going to give you a very simple example in a minute. The persistent diagram, I'm going to skip here, but beta function is going to be important here. So this is the most important slide for this part of the talk. So I give you a 5x5 image. Every pixel is a color value, 1 to 5. So I get my filtration. X1 means I am activating everything, every pixel with color value 1. This is my guy. X2 means I am activating everything up to 2. 1 and 2 are activated. X3 is I am activating everything up to 3. X4 is I am activating up to 4, etc. Now let's check our beta functions. How many components do you see in these guys? I see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 is here. I see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 is here. I see one component here, one component, 2 is here. One component, 5, 5, 2, 1, 1 is my beta vector for this 5 by 5 image. Beta 0 vector, 0 dimension. Now let's look at beta 1, loops. No loops here. No loops here. I have one loop, one hole here, and one hole here. So the corners are connected. One hole here, two here. Here I have one hole, and one hole, three here, and zero here. 0, 0, 2, 0, 3, 0 is my beta 1 vector. That's it. So these are going to be a very effective because of the here in this type of images, the noise is the real signature. We are going to see that. What we did here is, since so we look at five different tensor types, and for those, we look at every way possible the images. So what do I mean by that? So for each image, we get 8 color channels, meaning grayscale means every color picture has, every pixel has three coordinates, red, green, and blue, 0 to 255. Grayscale is on their average here. Just the average of R, G, and B guys here. So grayscale, red color, green color, and blue color, they are all giving me filtrations with their values, whatever it is. I don't know which one is going to work. I am just collecting all the information I can. I am just trying to get information out of this image, nothing else. And HSV is another color, like RGB, another color system. And we also use that. And it turns out in cervical cancer, HSV is much better than RGB here. We are going to see that. So I get 8 different color channels. Means for each pixel, I have a number between 0 to 255 here. For this one, and I have 8 different filtrations, and I have 8 different topological vectors, beta 0 and beta 1. I use 100 thresholds, 0 to 255, 2.5, 5, 7.5, and increasing like that. I get 100 dimensional beta 0, 100 dimensional beta 1, 8 color channels, 1600 dimensional vector for each image. This is topological vectors. We also used some, okay, these are the, okay. I'll come to that. Bone cancer. Let's look at bone cancer, what we get here. So in this one, this is representing gray color, only one color, beta zero vectors. I have three class here. Non-tumor, viable tumor, and non-viable tumor. It is a publicly available data. I'm going to explain what they are. And I am looking at their beta functions. So these are confidence bands, and the median curves are here. You can see that. So, and these are the real component size. So that means in 150 grayscale, I have a binary image, and that in that binary image, I have 400 components here. So I can see 400. These are not normalized. These are the real counts here. And you can see that in non-tumor, my component size, it's slightly connected, but in the other guys, it's disconnected mostly. So these are the topological patterns here. So when we started this project, this was our intuition. So in the whole slide image, when you have this tumor, you can see the tumor, but in the background, there must be some other changes too. The color values should change. There are non-visible changes we cannot see with the eye. And these are the small topological patterns you are seeing here. And this was our intuition, and it was right. Whenever we start a project, we first look at these images. Are topological vectors are working or not? This is the question we ask. Is it working or not? These figures are telling us, is it working or not? If they are very close to each other, it's not working. But if they are different classes are giving me different curves, then it is working. So the first thing we do, my students, I am also asking my students, let's get the beta vectors and other vectors. Let's see if they are doing good stuff. After that, it's machine learning. Yeah.
It also depends on how you choose your equation.
Exactly. This is grayscale. This is the grayscale, meaning this is only one color, beta 0 and beta 1. Let me show you column cancer.
Threshold.
Yeah. 100 thresholds here. 0 to 251 represents the year. I am representing as a function, but there are 100 thresholds, so 2.5, 5, it goes like that. 50 or 100 is a good number for this. But I mean, if you are going to do multi-parameter, 50 is a large number. We are going to, you should choose different, smaller number. But for single parameter, 50 or 100 is a good number. From a, yeah, I mean, you just need to get some information. But since you asked, let me explain this. After I get these vectors, this curves, I see that I don't see much difference here, and I don't see much difference here. I'm just going to focus on this interval. I can make it much finer. So I'm just going to plot all everywhere else. I'm just going to focus 100, 200, a much finer thresholding. You can do that too. But first, you need to understand what's going on with your data. After that, you can redecide for your thresholds. Yeah. Yeah. No. Okay, so machine learning is not working like this. This is just to understand, can I interpret what I am doing? After that, when you train the machine learning algorithm with this vector, this is a 100-dimensional vector. We get 2500 dimensional vector for each image. We have a 2500 dimensional space, and my XGBoost or CNN, whatever it is, splits this domain to parts. There is this is not about the machine learning part. This is just how vectors are distinguishing the classes. I'm just giving you an example, but machine learning works differently. If you give me some good training data, XGBoost splits the whole space into pieces. And it tells me what is going on. When you give me any data, it tells me which region it belongs to. No, I mean, this is just a curve. So what we do here is, this is the real picture. So. Forget the curves. Forget the curves. Curves are very misleading. This is a point in the. This is a point in a 100-dimensional space. If you give me here new points, it's not belonging to any of them. But my machine learning algorithm tells me it's closer to here. My guess is going to be blue. Of course, it's not going to go to everything. It's going to go to middle of the clusters. It can go somewhere else. But machine learning algorithm is some. Smart choices here, and it makes it. I'm gonna guess this blue. If it's not blue, then it's not a good choice. So the curves, we are not working with the curves. We are working with the vectors. Yeah. Of course, we are not getting 100% results. If we get 85, 90, we are very lucky. Of course. Yeah, so we are trying to increase these numbers to get some good models, yeah. Yeah. Okay, so when you look at this picture, yeah, here. Okay, now if your number of topological features a lot, okay, and now vectorization is coming from this persistent diagrams. Now, if you have a few number of topological features, few number of points in your persistent diagram away from diagonal, you use persistent surface, etc., persistent image, etc. But if you have lots of topological, lots of points close to diagonal, then all those vectorizations are going to give you very similar vectors. But beta numbers tells you in which one, how many components you have. Even though they are small features, the count of the noise is the real signature here, basically. Okay? Okay, so where am I? Here. In the column cluster, this is still gray color. Okay, here, cervical cancer, you see five different class, and HSV color channel, H is hue, S is saturation, V is value. In this one, the value color channel gives us very good result, and HSV average is also giving very good results here in BETI 1, BETI 0, and BETI 1. And prostate cancer, it looks very close to each other, but we get good results here. And don't forget that even though they look very close, if I have a separation in a very small interval, that's enough for me, basically. What is that? In that vector, I can distinguish them. These are, I have 100 dimensional space vector, and if one component is distinguishing them, my machine learning algorithm is just going to look at that component, nothing else, because I am distinguishing in that component. So I am just getting all the features I can get, and then I'm telling machine learning, I am trusting my machine learning algorithm, he is going to do the job for me. I'm just informing it, nothing else. And here, it's also hue. And breast cancer, again, HSV is working very well here. Okay, now, let me give the whole model. So we get 8 color channels and 200 dimensional with 100 dimensional BETI 0, 100 dimensional BETI 1 for each image, 1600 dimensional topological features. Local binary patterns is like 30-year-old computer vision algorithm, very simple one. You can call this like the father of convolutional neural networks, which is a similar idea. Local binary patterns are also giving you 800 dimensional features. And Gabor filters, another method used in histopathological images. We all collect all of them and put in a basket. These are my information. After that, we chose best 500 features. Now, good question is why 500? Why don't you go with 300? That's because of this. We can do the following. If you have some machine learning algorithm, you start with the number of features, how many features you are using. You start from zero features, and then you still, this is the how many features you are using, best features, and how much your accuracy is increasing. After 500, I have a steady state. So I am just choosing the best 500 of them. Why am I doing this? Because 2800 dimension is too much. I am using my XGBoost in a very high dimension, and it's using some effort in the unessential part. But if I focus on the 500 most important one, like you can use PCA or etc., so that in a lower dimension space, it's going to give better performance. And that's what it is going on here. So this is our flow chart. For each color, I have 8 color channels, 1600 topological features, 800 LBP, local binary patterns, 400 Gabor filters. We choose 500 out of them, and then we use our ML model, and we use XGBoost here. And the data sets are this. So for breast cancer, I have 400, I guess these are whole site images, and I have 1500 tiles, and 960 whole site images, 1000 tiles. This is the number of tiles. So you get a tissue sample, it's a large image, and then you just make the tiles. Some pieces are have cancer, some of them does not have a cancer. You are just trying to detect them, which ones are can have cancer. And these are the number of tiles. The more important information is here, they are all labeled by pathologists. So that's the stuff. And four class, five class, four class, three class. This is not an easy job. Binary classification might be easy, but five class is not so easy. So these are the results for all these guys. AUCs are very close to 99%, 0.99. But accuracy is changing. Here you can see these are our results for these guys. And let me show you the AUC is, okay, so let's say, let me give you a very dummy example. I have 100 different data set with 100 data, and three of them are abnormal, 97 of them normal, right? So if I guess everything normal, my accuracy is 97%, but it doesn't tell me anything because it's very unbalanced. So I am going to punish your wrong choices accordingly. So that, I mean, even though I have three, if you are making mistake in your earlier choices, I'm punishing them. So the ranking is also important in AUC. So your first choice should be right. Second choice should be right. Maybe 40th choice might be wrong, but I am penalizing them wrong. But if your first choice is wrong in 3 out of 100, then it's a very dummy one. Okay. So accuracy is this. So these are deep learning methods in the same data sets in the last 3-4 years. So we are almost there with these guys. But again, these guys are using heavy data augmentation, training, etc. And then they are creating some specific models to this breast cancer. But we have some global model for working for each cancer. And then we are choosing best 500 of them. And it is the same model work in everyone. So we are using same model in 5 different cancers. And these are our accuracies. But these results are deep learning models specifically trained for those cancers. So that's a different stuff. And you can see that our features are very strong. You can get to very close to the deep learning. And in prostate cancer, we are beating them. And in bone cancer. So these are the other metrics. And ablation study, most of the works here, yeah. I am not using PCA. That's a good question. I am using XGBoost best features. Means I am not changing my coordinates. In PCA, you are going some diagonally, but I know which 500. So I have 2800 dimensional vectors. I am choosing the best 500 of them. I am choosing subspace in the coordinate space. Yeah. Yeah, it's here. So here, that's a good question. Now, most papers here using only grayscale on this domain. So if you use only grayscale image, you see bone cancer 84%, but when you use all colors, you get 93%. So different color channels also using some information. In breast cancer, 68 to 88. In prostate, 91 to 94. In cervical, 54 to 92. And colon cancer, 95 to 98. And also, after you get all features, so you fit all information, but some of them are unnecessary. You just use feature selection, 500 features. You see some increases here. In this one, we are not increasing, but in the other ones, we are increasing. So this feature selection is also working well here. So this new color challenge is also very valuable. Yeah, these are publicly available. No. No. I mean, this is also interesting, but we already tried 5 cancer types. So I think to prove this is a working, I mean, our goal is not to get the whole model right away. We are just providing a new feature extraction method for the whole domain. So if you give me an image, I give you 200 dimensional vector. You can use this in CNNs. You can use this in another machine learning. So you have a very good algorithm, but you add this 200 dimensional vector concurrently with your vectors and then use them. So this is, we are trying to prove topological feature vectors are very useful here. Yeah. No, I don't know. No, but the thing is, so this is just the initial step. So we are going to combine them with CNNs. So we will have some architecture. CNN convolutional vectors will come here, and topological vectors come another way, and then we are going to combine them to get better vectors. So CNNs are getting some different information than this. We want to combine them. Okay. How much time do I have?
10.
Okay. So I'm going to skip this. The last one is in 10 minutes. I'm trying to finish in time. This is about drug discovery. This is a graph setting now. So image setting, point cloud setting we have seen. And drugs in the graph setting, I am looking at compounds as graphs. Nodes are atoms and bonds are edges here. This is a collaboration with Andaç Demir, Ignacio Dominguez, Yuju Chen, Yulia Gyal and Bülent Kızıltan. So this was published in NeurIPS like a year ago. Let me start with this slide. So this is drug discovery process. So you want to develop a drug and you have a very limited power in the wet lab, means so you cannot try hundreds of compounds in the wet lab, so clinicians, etc. You are trying to detect the best candidates, so because your pool contains millions of compounds and you want to find the best compounds to try in wet lab. The first step is about this step. Let's say you have 10,000 potential compounds. You need to choose best 250 compounds so that you can try in the wet lab. This process is called computer-aided drug discovery. You are using computers to choose the best 250 compounds to be tried in the wet lab. Virtual screening is the method is called here, and you want to get some good compounds. After that, in the wet lab, you are just choosing the five best compounds, and then you try to make them a good drug. Means you have the compound, but you have to have good delivery system to here. And then after you get this, you have a preclinical phase. You have to try it. You have to get FDA approval, and then it takes more than 10 years most of the time, and it costs more than $1 billion. But if you get it right, then your company stock goes up and then you are going to be very rich. Yeah. So let me show you what drug discovery means geometrically. Basically, what we have, any disease or any problem in our metabolism is coming from proteins. And the way they work is they have some small gaps. They attach to other cells. They attach to other proteins with these cells. And your drugs are small compounds filling this gap so that it's not going to work. So this guy is, for example, the function where the problem is emerging. So this is your large protein, but there is a gap here. It is attaching to somewhere so that it inhibits the work here, and it makes us sick. So my compound is attaching itself here, filling this gap so that it's not working anymore and I am fine. Now, you need to find some good compounds to fill that gap. Now, there are two methods here. One of them is called structure-based, means you understand the structure of the gap. You want to find some good compounds to fill that gap. This is really, really hard. Why is that? Because you need to understand three-dimensional structure. And even though you find the compound, there is an isomer problem, which means if you find a molecule here, single bonds are rotating. They can go anywhere. Even though you have some shape here, 5 minutes later, it can be a completely different shape. They don't stay. So there are lots of stuff. So because of that, this part is very hard. Ligand-based method, what we are going to do. So you don't know anything about, so you don't need to know anything about your gap, but you know some of the good compounds attaching here. So you have like 5-10 compounds. It's likely to work, but I don't know. We have some small candidates here. I am trying to find in my 1 million or 10,000 compounds similar to this guy. So this is basically graph similarity problem. I have 10 positive samples. These are likely to work. I have 10,000 compounds. I am trying to find the most similar guys to these 10 compounds. This is called ligand-based method. This is what we are going to do. Since I don't have time, this is the common method. These are Morgan fingerprints and smiles. For graphs, we have different filtration methods. So imagine this is a compound like this. This represents a compound. Here, red one represents, so gray ones are carbons, blue ones are oxygen, red ones are oxygen, blue ones are nitrogen, and white ones are hydrogen. I am looking at it as a graph. But I also know that, so this is a chemical compound. So I am going to use chemical functions in my filtration in the following way. Now, you give me a weighted graph, for example. Weighted graph. I can use node filtration or edge filtration in the following way. Remember, filtration means increasing sequence of topological spaces. I'm just going to give you a... So, sublevel filtration is really useful. There is simple idea, but it works very well in many cases. Here, these are my node values. 3, 4, 7, 9, and 5. So G5 means you activate all nodes whose value is smaller than 5. So you get these two guys. If there is an edge between them, you put them. G10 means you activate all nodes whose value is smaller than 10. You activate all of them except 15, and then 15 is here. So this is a node filtration. For edge filtration, we do the same. So look at the now edge values here. If the edge filtration means I am activating all edges whose value is smaller than 5, whose value is smaller than 10, whose value is smaller than 15. So I get a sequence of subgraphs. Now, if you use some good chemical functions coming from the domain, these are substructures coming from the domain. And if you can produce a good information out of the sequences, you can use them. So I'm going to produce some vectors out of this. So let me show you one picture. Since I couldn't tell about multipurposes, this is the only picture I'm going to show. I can use two functions at the same time for filtration. You see here, I have two node functions. One of them is the atomic weight. The hydrogens are atomic weight is 1, carbons are 6, nitrogens are 7, and not atomic weight, but atomic number. Red are atomic, oxygens are 8. So I am just using atomic weights for one coordinate. In the other one, partial charge coming from chemistry. Every compound comes with the partial charges. I am just looking at the substructures coming from this. This box means all nodes and edges, if there are one, whose value is atomic weight is smaller than 7, whose partial charge is smaller than 0.-0.1, I am activating them. I get the sequences. You can look at the number of components and loops, etc., or other kind of vectorization. You get some sequence of numbers. Okay, and then you get these matrices. And when we use them, okay. So do I have time?
2 minutes.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, just let me explain. The metric here is very important. So how do you measure your model is good here in this domain? Because I give you 10,000 compounds. You give me a model. Okay, how am I going to choose? Because you are trying to find the most similar ones to these 10 guys. This is called enrichment factor. How much do you enrich? How much do you increase the your chances from random choice? So means your, so for example, 1% enrichment factor means if I have 10,000 compounds, so if I choose the first 100 of them, the random choice will give me how many actives you have, whatever how many actives. So that means, so in 10,000 guys, let's say 70 of them really good compounds. I'm trying to find them. Okay? So your random choice is 70 over 10,000. That's your choice. But your model finds them in the first, let's say, 100, this 70 of them. This is a very good model because you are giving me this random guys in the first 100 guys. So this is called the enrichment factor. And how much do you enrich your random choice in your model? And this is the metric we are using. And our models with these topological features are really beat all these deep learning models with random forest. And this is vision transformers. This is deep learning. In a small data set, vision transformers work very well. In large data set, there are 100,000 compounds here. And we beat all these deep learning models with random forest. Very simple machine learning algorithm. So we produce the substructures, partial charge, atomic weight, or other bond strength, etc. And with those, we just use random forest, and then we beat all these deep learning models very effectively. Okay, so I'll stop here.
Great.
Yeah, multi-purposes, yeah. Zero and one. Yeah. Yeah. This is .E diverse data set. .E data set is 1 million compounds. .E diverse is they choose eight proteins. These are your target proteins, remember this picture. You fix a protein. And then they declare that, I mean, look at this protein and then look at this subset, 20,000 compounds, find the 50 compounds out of this. And your algorithm try to find these 50 compounds. It's all labeled, 20,000 compounds. Some of them are completely dummy compounds, but most of them for this protein are variable finding. That's the job. And then eight proteins are targeted here. And on this, so these are the results. Enrichment factors. No, it's not about the three-dimensional picture. It's about the graph similarity. Basically, now, I mean, atomic weight and partial charge we are using, for example, bond strength too. They are giving me some variable substructuring method. So I am telling you, bond strength is smaller than this, and atomic weight is smaller than this. It will give me it will give me some subgraph out of this. No, I don't go to the, because okay, since you ask, let me show you why I don't use three-dimensional. Okay, I can use three-dimensional, of course, point cloud setting here because I know the three-dimensional structure. The main problem with this, so we specifically go with 2D as a graph. The main reason is this conformation problem. You give a compound, any single bond can rotate. When they rotate, all the three-dimensional coordinates changing. Which one you are going to see? Same compound can have 50 different conformation. Which one is going to be? Because it's about the shape, but which shape you are going to take? That's why we are not using three-dimensional model. We are using two-dimensional because of this conformation problem. I mean, if you are going to structure-based, you are right, but we are using ligand-based. We are just blindly trying to find the most similar ones with algorithms. Again, so I am embedding them to some 50-dimensional space, and then my model is trying to find the most similar ones. And the thing is, what we get here is tell us the coordinates we get, the features we get are really meaningful in this domain. Yeah, there are lots of vectorizations. One of them is called Euler characteristics function. It's a linear combination of beta 0, beta 1. So since we already get good results with beta, and the real reason here is we want to interpret these results. Only beta function is interpretable here. If you go to persistent image or persistent landscape, the numbers does not mean anything for you. But if you have beta function, you know that at this binary image, threshold, I have 500 components. I can say that easily. So beta function is the only interpretable vectorization form. That's why it's, if it works, I am always keeping beta functions because I can interpret. Yes, but if you go to persistent landscape silhouettes, persistent images can give better results, but we cannot interpret them. There is no way because the location of the persistent diagram, how are you going to interpret? You don't know. That's the main reason.
I have a very general question. So how do you know if something, how do you know if TDA is useful for distinguishing the data set?
Yo, this,
So I mean, like what kind of tasks are more suitable. So you showed, I think, three examples, and all of them, I think, have the common feature of having someone with the visual perception can distinguish or somehow have an idea.
Yeah,
in that case, I can see some PDA might work essentially as a principle. Can I say that?
Let me give you my intuition. So when I see this image, I have a very good feeling that topological data analysis is going to work because there are lots of shape patterns here, which is not visually detected. So
the expert is going to distinguish. I think the medical doctor is going to look at it from that perspective, right?
Yeah.
Pure visual, okay.
Yeah. But if, for example, very simple picture like a cat picture, you cannot distinguish it because there is only one dominant figure, a dominant topological feature, and it can change. I mean, but if there are lots of topological features, tumor and non-tumor should develop different patterns. So that's the main idea.
Are there other classes of examples that are not shown but kind of not obvious that it is?
Yeah, for example, we had very good results with tuberculosis and pneumonia for chest X-rays. And it says just black and white picture. We just run TDA methods. It's amazing. I mean, we
on the lines.
Yeah, take a chest X-ray, and you want to detect pneumonia. It didn't work well with the other type of lung diseases, but pneumonia, tuberculosis, we get 99% straight away. And it's the curves are very different for normal and abnormal guys. It was, I mean, when we see the beta curves, we were like laughing. About 5 minutes, we get this. So it was really nice. Oh, really?
Yeah.
I don't know about revolution because I am also using that word because I want to publish papers and convince the reviewers. But I mean, TDA is giving you a very different information. If it works, it's very valuable. But if it doesn't work, I don't know. But if it's working in that domain, it's a different information. You can combine with anything you like. But I mean, depending on the context, it might be very valuable. I don't know. Yeah, for example, cat and dog pictures. You cannot distinguish them. There is no way. Because I mean, what features you are looking at? So you have two basic features, and they can be very close to each other. Yeah, nothing is there. So there is no pattern there for us, I mean. But if you have a complicated picture, for example, if you are looking at tissue classification, or you are doing some material science and texture classification. If you have seen some complicated pictures, it might work. Yeah. No, but when you change the colors thresholds, you should change the, I mean, number of components should change, etc. I mean, that means it can be grayscale or it can be color picture. It can be a complicated picture for you. You cannot distinguish with eye, but it can be some patterns in different color threshold. No, it's not one-to-one process. But I mean, you can find something, but it may not be the one with the real one. It's not one-to-one process. Okay, so since you ask, I'm going to show the picture. Okay, now these are the filtrations we use. Now, there is a complicated filtration type, BR30 strips. We also use it for distances. Basically, if two nodes in the graph has distance 5, I can detect them through this idea. I skip that part. So, atomic mass and distance. Partial charge and distance, bond type and distance are my filtrations. Atomic mass and partial charge is another filtration type. And I can use three functions Those are the results I get. These are all coming from this machine learning. Yeah. But so we specifically see that single filtration and multi filtration is completely different. Multi filtration is working very well here. Two domain functions. Whatever you are going to use from my experience, don't use just random functions. Find functions from domain. For example, if you are doing finance, you need to use transaction amount in your groups. These are the meaningful information there. We use like blockchain data. We use this transaction amount to work very well. Come from the domain of the group. Get some meaningful substrate.
Any other questions? Okay, so if not, let's thank Boris again.